Okay, so I got about two-thirds of the way through my sort of overview talk last time. And so I want to finish that up, but what I want to do first is tell you a little bit, you know, it's hard to cover sort of the big chunk of sort of the development of a field that, you know, is sort of the basis of working in it. But what you can do in a short time is you can cover sometimes some very simple things that you can explain on the board that everybody can follow in detail, and then you can give an overview. And so that's my plan, to just sort of split it down the middle and leave out the sort of big chunk in the middle. And so what I wanted to show you now, where I got at in the overview was I got to the idea. So I talked about you know, a broad view of different numerical methods, including exact diagonalization, quantum Monte Carlo. Then I got over to the idea of low entanglement methods, tensor network states. And I got to the idea of a matrix product state. And they still probably look sort of formal, and some of you are very familiar with them, but some of you, it may look sort of formal. And so I wanted to just write down the very simplest possible matrix product states. You can have some simple examples with just a few sides, just to make it a little bit more concrete. And so that's mostly what I'm going to be doing on the board here. So we have matrix product states. NPS. Okay. So these were the states that arise naturally when you have low entanglement and you want to have some sort of compressed form of wave function. And so what I finished off with last time is that if we have, say this is a, let's keep it just as a spin one-half system for simplicity, and the wave function for all these spins, this exponentially large things to the n number of coefficients, can be written as this matrix product . Okay, so the structure of this algebraic equation is that on the left hand side I have a function, gives me a complex number if you tell me the up down pattern of the spins that you want. On the right-hand side, there's, so first of all, the leftmost A is a vector, and the rightmost A is another vector, and, you know, so you can make them their own column vectors. You're just trying to contract the whole thing to get a scalar, okay? All the middle ones are matrices, okay? And then there's actually two copies of each matrix, and so as soon as you say whether S is up or down, then that tells which one to take. And so if you take some pattern here, it tells you what pattern of A's to contract, and you get a single number. Okay? And so this huge exponentially large number of numbers is generated by a much smaller number of complex numbers over here. It's sort of a compressed form here. You know, and then you see, you just give the S, and it tells you to compute a number. But this doesn't have to have nearly as many parameters to express it. Okay, so to make this more concrete, let's write down a two-side wave function and then write it in a matrix product form. And let's take our favorite two-side wave function, the singlet. Okay, so let's say we have psi is 1 over root 2, up, down, minus down, up. Okay. So I can write this as sum on S1, S2, A1 of S1. Okay, and then it'll just be a dot product because I don't have any middle tensors. So A1 dot A2 of S2, S1, S2. And so let me rearrange this by grouping the state S1 over here with this this vector A1. So I can write this as sum on S1, A1, S1, state S1, and then put the dot product here, sum on S2, A2, Okay, we usually don't absorb the states into the matrices like this, but it's nice to do a little analytic example that you can write this in a particularly compact form. Okay, so it's just a broad dot product of two objects, and these two objects are vectors, but they're vectors that have states. You know, so here it's states of spin one on the left-hand vector, and here's states of spin two on the right-hand side. And so you can see by inspection, so I'm going to define this guy as just A1 without the square bracket S1, and this one's A2. Okay, and then A1 is 1 over root 2 up, 1 over root 2 with a minus sign down. Okay, and then A2 is down and up. Okay, and so you can see by inspection, just do the dot product in your head, you can see that I recover psi by taking the dot product of these two guys. Okay? So I sort of separated out the wave function into these two parts. One of them just lives on psi 1, the other one lives on psi 2. In this case, it was a dot product because we only have two sites. Okay? So if you do more sites, you get matrices coming out. So let me do a little example with three sites. So let's just take as our wave function some sort of symmetric state with two up and one down. So this is a 1 over root 3 normalization and up, up, down, plus an up, down, up, plus a down, up, up. So, okay. So let me just write down the answer. So again, I'm going to group the spin with the particular vector or matrix. And there's so first of all, there was, you can see in the very first example that there was choices that that are sort of trivial that can be made. So for instance, there's this 1 over root 2 factor that could be put on either side. And so this is actually an important ingredient in matrix product states, that you can put factors in different places, and it's sort of like a gauge choice. And we make use of that. Often we want certain orthogonality properties of the matrices that are involved. We want the certain pieces to be orthogonal in a certain direction, and other pieces to be orthogonal in another direction. And so we make use of that in order to make the calculations much simpler to perform. And so there's always this sort of gauge degree of freedom of, you know, there's minus signs, there's factors that can be put in different places. Okay, so in this case, I can use that freedom to make the two outer vectors to be particularly simple. I'm going to make this up. Down. Okay, and then that's also equal to A3. And then if I do that, you can have to take A2, and so I'll put a 1 over root 3 out here, down, and then up, and up, and a 0. Okay, so if you just you have a product of vector matrix vector, you can work on this and try to figure it out. You know, do it all in your head and see that each of these pieces of the wave function are generated by this particular product. And any wave function of the three sides could have been represented with the same size. Same size tensors, and in fact, the first two could have been left the same. And the number of degrees of freedom in this last one, A2, is I can put whatever coefficient I want in here next to a down and next to an up. So there's actually eight numbers that this encodes, which is just the number of possible different many-body states for these experiments. Okay? So this is, you sort of see this is a very simple representation, and that's just up to three sites. Well, what happens when you do a larger system? So when I went to three sites, I stopped having vectors and I needed a matrix. If you go to more sites, you don't get anything bigger with more indices than a matrix. All the middle ones are still matrices. That's because of the matrix product state form in general. But to represent an arbitrary state, the size of the interior matrices is going to get exponentially big. In the end, if I want to represent absolutely any state without any sort of compression possible, then the number of parameters has to be fixed. It has to be whatever I gave it, so it has to be 2 to the n. So the size of the internal matrices is going to grow exponentially. Okay, but the point of thinking about entanglement is that there's a sort of direct relationship between a state that has low entanglement, say something that satisfies an area law, and these matrices that you get in the center being able to be small so that it's a real compression. And that's the key to the matrix product state representation.
Yeah. These matrices here are 2 by 2, but you went to 4 sites or something, you might need to...
So if I went to 8 sites, you know, maybe I need on the order of 2 to the 4 by 2 to the 4.
Maybe.
Something like that, yeah. Yeah. So I'm not sure if I just bump up one site whether it actually gets any bigger or not. Maybe I can stay the same size with 4, but any bigger than that, it makes it very difficult. Okay. Okay, so then this sort of little game you can play, it's just, you know, simple algebra. We can do the same sort of thing with operators. And then you get something called matrix product operators, which we frequently use to represent Hamiltonians. So this is something that we didn't understand in DMRG until much, in quite a ways after DMRG was invented, but then now if you write it in some of these things, some of these ways with matrix product states, it looks easy. Matrix product. Operators, or MPOs. Okay, so let me do, again, a simple example. Let's take a Hamiltonian icing, your neighbor Hamiltonian, just the classical terms. So, let's take an S1, Z, S2Z, plus an S2Z, S3Z. Okay, so if you want to write the matrix product operator, let's see. So first of all, when I was writing the matrix product states, you know, there are states up here that are associated with one particular site, but it's easy to keep track of them just by the order. You know, you get some sort of up or down for each site, and so they just come out in order. You keep them in order, and you keep track of them. For the operators, you don't have an operator on every site. And so to keep track of the way this comes out, the first thing we want to do is actually expand these. So the S1Z, S2Z, in this three-site space that I'm going to use, I can think of a 1 operator on site 3. Okay, and we don't usually write that, it doesn't do anything, but it's, if you really think about the structure of this space here, that should be there. And 1 on site 1, S2Z, S3Z. Okay, so once I do that, then I can write, it's essentially the same size. Well, it comes out to be the same size. It's generally, it's a bigger possibility when you look at the space of operators, but it comes out the same size of just length 2 vectors and matrices. Okay, so A1 is going to be the 1 operator, and now I'm going to associate the index on it to keep track of them, and SC1 is Okay, and so the reason I get this is what I need to write down for one is that if I sort of draw a line here, separating off the site one stuff, there's only two possibilities. There's SD or Y. And if I have SA3, well, it turns out it's there's different ways of representing it. I'm going to represent it with the SZ coming first. So SC3, again, I need a 1 on site 3. Okay, and then for this Hamiltonian, the A2 is SC2, 0, 0, SC2. Again, just multiply them together, and algebraically you see that you recover this Hamiltonian. Okay, so now the matrix product operators, this is sort of a simple hand construction. And that's still the way we usually do matrix product operators for the Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian is not that many terms. It's not an exponentially growing number of terms. And so we can just construct them with hand, by hand, and there are simple rules that are, you know, especially convenient for doing, say, a translationally invariant system, but they're not so hard if it's not translationally invariant. All the rules are pretty easy. And so the typical dimension for a long chain, if we had, say, this sort of icing Hamiltonian just on every site, it would be probably dimension 3. All the matrices would be 3 by 2 matrices. If it was a Heisenberg, it would be 5 by 5. You know, so you need 1s and then the different components of S, SC, S plus, S minus. And there's a very simple rule for constructing them. And all of the interior matrices can be identical to each other. And so we can encode a Hamiltonian in terms of these matrix product operators and do that at the start of a calculation and do all the sort of organization of, you know, what is this thing that we're working with. And then, you know, we still have the, you know, there's different types of Hilbert spaces that this could live in. But once we've sort of encoded the matrix product operator, then every sort of DMRG calculation can look the same. It's just like, it's just working on different matrices. And the old way of doing DMRG was in terms of sort of keeping track of all of the pieces that we need to construct Hamiltonians separately, give them names. And here we just encode it all in operators.
So I assume that the MPOs are exact as the states.
Yeah, so for the Hamiltonian, the MPOs are exact. For the matrix product states, you have this, the size of the space is exponentially large, but it's compressible. But it's compressible with some sort of tail of probabilities that you're going to put some cutoff in. And so there'll be sort of states that you throw away below some cutoff. And that will translate into the size of the interior matrices. That size is normally a parameter n. M is just there's n by m matrices in the inside. So that's a truncation. For the matrix product operators for the Hamiltonian, we just write them out exactly. And using simple rules, it's sort of trivial, but it's very useful for getting organized. Okay, but there's another use for these matrix product operators, which is much more like the use of matrix product states. So suppose we want to calculate the thermal density matrix, E to the minus beta H. Okay, that's something with the same sort of operator structure as the Hamiltonian, but it's a very non-trivial thing. And so a non-trivial use of these matrix product operators is, for example, to encode an approximate representation of, say, E to the minus beta H, where we do the same sort of truncation of small pieces, small probability pieces. It looks very much like by doing it with an ordinary state, called the Schmidt decomposition. We use singular value decomposition to sort of find the compressed form. And so you can do a very sophisticated thing with things with matrix product operators. So that's one of the nicest ways of getting finite temperature with DMRG, is you just work in this operator space and essentially treat it very much like a DMRG type algorithm. But you sort of directly compute, sort of starting at finite temperature and sort of working your way down to lower temperatures, you work with this. So all of these methods, there's some sort of compressibility of the wave function or the operator that's built into it. And so if we try to compress a certain thing for a certain accuracy, there will be some sort of size of the matrices that we need to use. It's an inherent property of the system and how we set it up. And so it could be that it becomes out of reach. It could be that something's too hard for us to use. It could be our computer needs to be bigger. But there's always that sort of limitation. But for low entangled states for wave functions in 1D, that's when everything is wonderful, and you know, keeping on the order of 50 or 100 states, you can get very accurate results. Sort of, you know, the DMRG for 1D systems is sort of on a level where you can not only do it on your laptop, you can do it on your laptop on a plane with no plug. And still do sites, several hundred sites, yeah.
So, of course, whenever you talk about states, you talk about these the size of the matrices. So, when you go back to if we go back to transfer matrices in one of these static problems, the size of the transfer matrix, I was trying to sort of, see if there's any similarity. So the size of the transfer matrix is just controlled by the width of the strip. Whereas here, the size of the most difficult problem here is controlled potentially by the configurations of the entire chain.
Right.
So is there, when you say that there's only 100 states, is there sort of a sense of locality?
So in the thermal case, the way you actually do the calculation and the way you can think about it is that you can compose e to the minus tau h. You do a Trotter approximation so that your e to the minus beta h is first of all a product of e to the minus tau h's, where tau is small. Do one at a time. And then you Trotter those guys, so that means that you turn something that's an operator of the whole system into a product of commuting bond operators. And so you're actually only working with an exponential of two sites at a time within a reasonable approximation. So then what you need to crank up to the full beta that you want to get is to put layers of these. We think of them in terms, I'm going to show you the diagrams in just a second on board, and we just think of these gates, these two sites connected to two site gates, put in a layer, put in another layer. And to go to a finite temperature, you only need a finite number of layers. So each layer generates a certain amount of entanglement in this operator sense. And if you don't need an infinite number of layers, because it's saying the system is controlled by gap, where you're only going to limit the temperature, then the size of the matrix can't get too big.
So I don't know whether you want to comment on this or not, but for one-dimensional systems, there's no issue of ordering, right? But if you are more than one dimension, how well MPS works depends very much on the ordering.
Yes. So, and you can always, even in one dimension, you can always choose a bad ordering. It will make things sort of infinitely bad.
You have to be very good.
Yes. So if I put all the odd sites first, and then all the even sites next, every nearest neighbor term in the Hamiltonian will generate a strong entanglement that reaches all the way across the system. And so the compressibility will be near zero. You get the exponentially big matrix five state. Okay, so we keep everything in order that tries to respect the physical nature of correlations. You know, real space is sort of special for tensor network space, DMRG. Case space things don't work as well. Real space things talk to each other locally, and you can cut the system in two, and the things on the interior are only going to be weakly entangled with the things on the interior on the other side, and we make use of all of them. But it depends on exactly how you do that. And sometimes there are real choices on how you have something with a non-trivial lattice, and there's different ways of.
The fact in 3D, it's highly non-obvious what's the optimal order.
Well, it's not so much that, it's just that all orderings are bad. So the way you think about it is, okay, so I have a 3D system and I want to cut it in two. Okay, and so I'm going to get to the area law. I talked about the area law. So the area law says that the entanglement entropy is proportional to the area of the cut. So it's a two-dimensional area, so that gets big really fast. And so that's the central problem when you're doing it with this particular representation, where you're trying to keep all the different states that are sort of fluctuating across the cut are lumped together in this one-dimensional DMRG sort of way of doing it. Okay? So what you really need to do in a 3D case is think about cuts, where all the different fluctuations across the cut are carried by separate links in the tension network. And so that's not necessarily out of reach. It hasn't really been done yet, but people are certainly thinking about it.
If you're doing like chemistry, on a given site, you can have bottom up.
Right.
And there are issues.
So there's DMRG has found its place in quantum chemistry. It has a niche where it does better than other things, and of course there's other problems where it doesn't do as well. But you have to work hard to understand the locality. You know, there you sort of think of positional locality and sort of energy or occupancy locality. You know, you don't, if something is a core state fully occupied, you just want to treat it as a core state and not have somehow split it up in some sort of representation that splits it. So it's lots of interesting questions with that. Okay, so let me say a little bit about the diagrams. So these two key ideas are sort of really central that you can sort of talk the game if you understand, like, okay, what I've just written down here, and then how the diagrams work. And the diagrams are really simple, and then there's a lot more details that go in doing the calculations, but you can talk the game. What are the diagrams? So the diagrams have a lot of similarity to Feynman diagrams in the sense that they're internal legs and external legs. And the internal legs in the Feynman diagram are integrated over. And the internal legs in our tensor network diagram are just discrete degrees of freedom, but they're summed over. Okay? And then there are vertices which we associate with the tensor. So the main diagram for one of these A's looks like this. So this would be A sub I. It'd be the interior because I'm drawing both the indices. And so A sub I we were thinking of as a matrix. And so L and K are the matrix indices. Okay, and then I have a guy sticking up, which was the spin index, S sub I. Okay, so I've just written out, there's it's this explicit form, all the degrees of freedom without using this sort of compressed notation. And so this is the number of degrees of freedom for one of these. That's an operator, but let's say this A over here. Okay, and so that's the diagram, and then we can stick these together. And for the left-hand side, our vector, now we write out explicitly the states that were inside the vector, and we have a vector index here. And this would be the form of A sub 1. Okay, over on the left hand side, we have Sn, and say P, and this is A sub n. Okay? And then we put them all together and can write equations that look like this: psi of S1 up to Sn. And it just looks like a cone. S1 up to Sn. Okay? And so every circle is one of these matrices or tensors, depending on what you want to call it, A2, A3, A4, etc. And all of these internal legs get contracted over. The closed line indicates that. And that's just the matrix multiplication, where you do multiplications and the indices get summed over. And then you put in the last vectors, and it contracts it all, so that the only thing left are these external lines. And so this is sort of the notation for an object that has n degrees of freedom to the n possible numbers in this contracted diagram. So in the contracted form, just look at all the possibilities here. That encodes to the n numbers. But if you look at it in the individual form and look at the storage that you needed for that, there's some dimension here that is the key parameter that controls the compression. And if m, well, if whatever m is, the size of these objects are m times 2. So order m squared degrees of freedom, times the number of sites, and that's the total number of storage. So that's what gives you the, that's only linear in the size instead of exponential in the size. So it's a drastic compression. Okay, and that's the diagrams. Okay, so let me give you another example. So, sort of a more general purpose one. Suppose I had trace of three matrices. Okay, so for tensor networks are basically the idea of writing wave functions and operators in terms of sort of these component pieces. And the network, the tensor network, can be arbitrarily complicated if you have some good reason for making it arbitrarily complicated. You know, so it doesn't just have to be lined up in a line. They could be some sort of higher dimensional network. And there are good reasons for thinking of these sort of higher dimensional networks. I mean, the simplest thing, though, is just to say, well, my system is two-dimensional. Why shouldn't my network be directly two-dimensional with connections between all the nearest neighbors? And so that's the idea of PEPs. So back to this simple example in terms of the diagrams, that's just A, B, C, contract it, and then the trace closes the loop. And so you see right away, of course, the property of the trace is that you can cyclically commute things. You see it by the diagram. Okay. So this diagrammatic notation is really useful. It was one of the things that held us back in the early days of DMRG. And then the quantum information people started joining the sort of DMRG tensor network effort. And one of the immediate things that they started doing was doing these diagrams, because they had been doing circuit diagrams for quantum circuits. And it's like, oh yes, of course we do this. And then all of a sudden everything is much clearer, rather than just sort of working with this sort of algebraic form. And the last thing, yeah.
For the concrete case you have on the top of it,
yeah.
A1 and A2, what is the corresponding vector?
Well, it's just this. Okay, so for the A1 up there, no, it's up down. Okay, so
if that S equals an up, would that mean it's a 1, 0?
Yes.
And S equals to down, that means it's 0.
Let's see, I think A1 is just 1, 1, 0, 0, where you say, let's make this index the S1, and then there's a vector index called I, say. It goes along the other direction. Okay? And then you just have the two states. And you just say, okay, that's up, and index 1. And so that's, you just expand the vectors into matrices. And we don't, for the ordinary case of the three indices, we don't have a three-dimensional chalkboard to write it down. That's all there is to it. Okay, last on the board, for these matrix product operators, the diagrams, first of all, for an operator, suppose I had SC, we think of this in terms of its matrix representation in terms of spins. And that means that S of C looks like this, where I have an S and an S prime. Okay, those are the two spin indices that represent the sort of component, the operator sort of before the, on the left, right of the matrix and the left of the matrix. So you can just write that down as a matrix, so if you see it has two indices, so it's a matrix operator of matrices. But this is all in the spin language, S. Okay, and then when you put this together into the MPO, the diagram looks like this. So all the bottom we can write S's, S1, S2, Sn, and S1 prime to Sn prime. So it's just double indices sort of going up and down to reflect the fact that on each side it's an operator. Yeah.
Yeah. How do you visualize the SVD as a
As a diagram?
Yeah, as a diagram.
Yeah, so what the SVD does, the SVD is the crucial thing that we use to form the compression, to make the compression. And so what an SVD does is it splits a matrix into a product of matrices. So the simplest case would be if I had, say, my two-site tensor like this, this can be written as this. Okay, so this has two indices And so it could be that this is sites, but it could also be that this represents a lot of states. And so this has two indices, so it's a matrix. So I use the SVD matrix factorization, which says that, say, a matrix M goes over to a UVV transpose. And so this would be the U, and this would be a diagonal matrix, and this would be the V transpose. Okay. So that's what an SVD looks like. And this is our basic tool. And the way that it's a tool, it could just be an identity if you keep all the degrees of freedom. But this diagonal matrix represents sort of components of the wave function in a way that's ready to be compressed. So there's this is diagonal with a lambda 1 going down to a lambda some maximum. That's the form of D. Okay, and the probability of a part of the wave function, probability, let me just call it state 1, is lambda 1 squared. Okay, so the key idea of EMRG is to take these lambdas, put it in this form that expresses all the pieces in terms of these probabilities in such a way that low entanglement tells you that only a few of the lambdas are big. So you take the lambdas that are below some cutoff, like 10 to minus 8, and you throw them away. Okay, and throwing them away means you just sort of replace the full D matrix by a smaller guy, throw away the other pieces, and all of these things, these indices here get shrunk, and so it's like 2 to the n goes down to m. It's not the same m, let's call it m. And this guy goes down to m. So the truncation says, look at this form, so these probabilities get really small, we throw them away, use that to shrink the size of the tensors, and we get a compressed form. So we use this singular value decomposition sort of all over the place to shrink something that could be much bigger, shrink it down to a small size. Or a lot of the algorithms, the key to these algorithms is never to represent anything in the expanded size, because then if you need to represent it in the exponential size, you can never do it consistent. So what you do is you start in some tiny size, and then you need some sort of iterative thing that pushes the system towards the ground state, and it'll be this thing like, you know, diagonalizing a Hamiltonian in some sort of subspace, or hitting it with a Trotter gate to push it in imaginary time towards lower energy. It will tend to make all the tensors bigger, and then you throw in the SVD to shrink it back down to size. And so you just keep it all controlled by repeatedly, you know, taking pairs of them and multiply them together, do the SVD to shrink them down. And so this is sort of generically how all of these tensor network calculations work, including the EMRG. Good, okay, so let me switch back over to this overview. So we want to set up here. So we want the shades and the screen. Yeah.
There are steps that involve SVDs, which are out of cost calculation, but the ones where the system side doesn't grow. Okay. Those kind of, for example, SVDs or UV, are they guaranteed to converge? Are they guaranteed to converge at the same level?
Well, okay, so there's kind of a subtle issue which, you know, I might have, if I had more time for the board, I probably would have gotten to next. The subtle issue is that when you, what you're really worried about in this sort of thing is what truncation am I doing to the wave function itself? So when the wave function is written in this expanded matrix product form, then if you do a truncation using the SVD, you would like that truncation of the SVD to directly translate to an error in the wave function. Now that will generally be true if the thing that you're doing the SVD on has legs sticking out that sort of connect with the rest of the system. And if those legs connect to orthonormal states, then the truncation of your tensor will be perfectly identical to truncation of the wave function. And that turns out to be always easy to guarantee with EMRG, that your truncation with the SVD, you know, always know exactly what you're doing. It tells you immediately if the sort of the probability thrown away is the amplitude squared of the wave function you threw away. In the more complicated tensor network, this is one of the central problems, that as soon as you have the tensor network connected in loops, you can't just pick one index and say that's an orthonormal set, because it's connected in a loop to some of your other indices. It's only all the external indices together that can form an orthonormal set if you orthonormalize. But that's a major problem. In the general tensor networks like PEPs, there's two things going on. One is a much nicer representation of the wave function in terms of connecting correlations and entanglement on the bonds that are physical, because you're in the right number of dimensions. But you have loops. And so when you do this, your computational algorithms for doing it are screwed up. They don't work in quite the right way. And so this is an area where people are constantly trying to improve them. So if you use these methods, the current algorithms, they can give you the proper truncation, but at a much higher cost. And so right now, the fancy tensor networks and EMRGs are sort of in a nice stage where they're complementary. They sort of have similar capabilities, one better for one thing and the other better for another thing. I'll show you a little bit of that. But eventually we hope that we understand how to deal with this sort of loop structure of the tensor networks better, so that those can really take over time.
So the tensor FCDs in the higher dimensions are not, there are many flavors, right?
Yeah.
So how do you make the choice of the tensor SVDs?
Well, okay, that's sort of a higher level decision on how you're going to arrange the algorithm. Sometimes people put constraints on the tensors to make the problem go away. So for instance, the Mira tensor network has unitarity constraints on the tensors that make a lot of these problems go away, but still the high dimensional structure of it gives you, they're very expensive computations still. And then PETS has much weaker constraints, and then people have a variety of different ways of organizing that to try to get the most efficient representation of the wave function as a function of the time of calculation. Okay, so here I am back to the overview, and we have major spotted states, and hopefully you have a better field, and there's a diagram for these. Okay, then we need to get to the ground state by staying in the compressed form, and so that involves sort of looking at only just one or two sites in the center and optimizing those, and then sweeping those couple of sites back and forth. Okay, so there's a sweeping algorithm in VMRG that goes and optimizes each of these tensors and goes through the whole system and eventually pushes the whole thing to the ground state. And this works really well for one dimension, and this is the sort of thing that you can do on your laptop all the time. Okay, so the picture here was showing this sort of vast problem that we're trying to solve of solving many body systems. You can think of it as sort of the sine problem in general, but we've sort of broken off a piece of it that for your typical realistic Hamiltonian in one dimension, EMRG takes care of that, and that's gone from our list of difficult problems. Okay, so here's two ways of going to two dimensions. Both of them are very useful. Okay, so we can take the matrix product state in a one-dimensional form, and we can take a finite width strip, and we can map 2D to 1D just by drawing a line that goes through the system along some path. And then the matrix product state, the physical indices are sticking up. And so the structure of this in terms of the tensors is just one-dimensional. We've mapped it reliably into one dimension. However, there is entanglement. There's Hamiltonian bonds that connect here that induce strong entanglement, say, between these two sites. These two sites are far away along the path, so that entanglement essentially has to flow through all of these indexes, all of these sort of, you can think of these like communication lines, and all of this entanglement has to flow through here, where it's crowded out by all the entanglement. So that's going through the same thing. All of the entanglement for this whole cut is flowing through that one line there. And so that's the fundamental limitation of the sort of traditional BMRG method for higher dimensions. This index, and then actually it's all of the other things too, has to be very large. It has to grow exponentially in the width of the system. So this is associated with an area law. The entropy goes as the width of the system, and the number of states you need to keep grows exponentially with the entropy, so exponentially with the width, and so that's our problem. From the calculational point of view, these calculations, because of their one-dimensional nature, because the SPD always works the way it's supposed to, several things, these calculations are scaled very nicely. M is the size of one of these indices, and N cubed is the best we can ever do, and so this is very good, and so we get M can go up to, say, on the order of 10,000 once we're using some of the synergies and doing all the pictures we can. So for a two-dimensional system, say a Heisenberg's minimum half system, the current state of ours would be with traditional BMRG, it's like up to width about 12 or 14. The length of the system doesn't matter very much, because that doesn't strongly associated with being a piece of time. Okay, then here's one of the key higher dimensional tensor networks. So you can focus on one particular tensor and see that it has five indices, four of them going to the nearest neighbors. So each dot is a physical, you know, the location of one of the, say, spins of the system. And then it has a physical index sticking out on each site. And so five indices. And so the fact that it's connected in the right way to express the entanglement means that you hope that this bond dimension can work with a very small size. So on the order of 10 to 20 seems to work very well for many systems. Okay, but the calculation time, because of these only sort of technical difficulties, they have a calculation time that people usually write as scaling about. There's some assumptions in there, but scaling is m to the 12. That's a huge calculation time. And so makes a huge difference between m equals 10, 20, 10, 30. So 10 is fine, and people are, you know, the best calculations are pushing into the teens with the size of these.
So if you were to do Kepp's weird lattice with no loops but still four nearest neighbors for
like a beta lattices were done early on with BMRG with no technical, you know, very few technical issues. They just worked great.
But just using the idea of having a tense, because you have the nearest neighbor be three or four sites or something like that.
Yeah.
Would the efficiency go way up?
Well, you don't even think of it as a PETS. It's a tree. And so the PETS implicitly sort of includes the idea that you have the loops. And so PETS on a beta lattice is a tree tensor network. And tree tensor networks are essential, almost as easy as 1D lattices, maybe it's 1D. So you may have a higher coordination number that translates to some higher power of M. But if, you know, each link will give you one higher power of M. And but the key thing is that because it's there's no loops, you can take each index of each tensor and say that corresponds to an orthonormal basis. So I can do all my truncation in this perfect way very easily. So and people realize that even before we have the tensor network diagram. There's some, you know, mid-90s calculations on the paper lattice.
Sufficient for
y equal to 12 or 14. So, you know, it depends. For reasonable accuracy, but, you know, they get nice results. Yeah.
So the green line corresponds to where you want to do the SVD truncation, right?
So the green line is sort of associated with your estimation with the area law. The green, you have some sort of line that cuts the system in two. And then based on that cut, you look at the area that cut gives, and that gives you the entanglement area, gives you the entanglement entropy equals the area law.
So the area law tells you about the scaling of the lambdas, right? As well?
Yes.
So the green line would correspond to where you want to do SVD classification.
Well, the green line, so I do the green line sort of as a two-dimensional object showing a cut in two dimensions. It also corresponds to a one-dimensional cut in this case. And there's a one-dimensional cut, you know, on one link. And so in that sense, it's telling you where to do the SVD.
Okay, but what is a loop? Where you, this here you're showing a non-open boundary condition, right? So if you connect the ends,
yes.
Do you still do the same cut, or you have to cut both?
You need to cut both.
Okay.
So in this representation, you need to cut both. However, as soon as the diagram started being written and people, you know, were drawing diagrams with a trace, then people realized that you could organize it in a better way. And you could just have the matrix product states connect themselves in a loop. So it's still one-dimensional but closed in the loop. There are specialized algorithms for the loop MPS. And some of the, eventually we got those to scale as M cubed. So those are pretty good algorithms, but we still haven't applied them to 2D. Partially because, you know, we usually don't really need periodic boundary conditions to understand the system, and it's just more complicated. But it scales the same way. So I wanted to show an example of a 2D DMRG calculation from the TJ model. I'll mostly let this run, but it turns out it's very useful to see how DMRG finds the ground state. So there's this sweeping process that goes back through the system with a sort of snake-like path, and you can kind of see it being quicker. And the system slowly tries to go towards the ground state, and as it goes, you can keep track of the energy. And then the controlling parameter is the number of states, which we slowly increase, because it doesn't make any sense when it's far from the actual ground state to try to have higher accuracy. So we increase M by M as we increase the sweeps. And so you can see what if you just have the final result of the calculation, there's uncertainty about did it really find the right ground state. So it's very useful to make these movies to sort of see as the calculation goes along how it sort of found ground state. So this is a TJ model calculation showing the local expectation value of SVD as an arrow up or down. The colors are encoding whether there's a domain wall. So blue is one domain and green is the other. And then the size of the circles is showing the probability of a hole being on that side. And so the initial calculation looked a lot like this on the right, and it was all the holes in the clump. And the calculation sort of all naturally forms into stripes in a way that if you see the movie, you can tell that that's what it wants to do. It's not associated with the ends because the holes haven't even reached the ends yet. It just spontaneously, to try to lower the energy, it forms these stripe patterns. So we were seeing these back in the late 90s in the TJ model. And so when we first saw them, we did not expect them. There were some Hartree-Fock calculations that showed these, but we didn't trust the Hartree-Fock at all. So it's like, there shouldn't be any. What is this thing? We had no idea what it was, so we just tried to get rid of it. And so you try various starting states for the DMRG to see if they go away. So for one thing you do is to try to mess up the domain wall structure. So here it's got a pattern that's inconsistent with two stripes. It tries to force one stripe. But that's just sort of the initial condition. And so this one takes a little bit longer to sort out what it wants to do. But then you'll see the domain wall sort of spontaneously fix itself. So there's some randomness in the initial thing that sort of picks one side as sort of the weaker side. And so then it flips this side. Mm-hmm. And then it's sort of, all of a sudden, it's sort of gone over some bump in its path towards the ground state, and it's happier and wants this something that was much less than these stripes. And yeah, so this is, you know, we can now keep about 10 times as many states, and we still see the same basic behavior going on. And we're trying to figure out, you know, what is the detailed nature of these stripes, and you know, the competition between stripes and superconductivity, you know, mostly they seem to be able to coexist. So that's some calculations on the TJ model. More recently, we looked at the CAGM-A system and found that it was a spin liquid. But the leading competitor to the spin liquid was a valence bond solid. So here, each of the thickness of the bonds is showing S dot S. And we put it initially into a state that has the sort of chief competitor. We put it into the chief competitor state. And then we try to see, you know, there may be biases in the calculation, but we turn all the biases in favor of the guy that we're proving doesn't exist. And then this calculation shows, despite all the biases, that it goes to the real spin liquid. And the chief bias here, you can see when this red green guy was bouncing around, I guess it's gone now, so it's, it will go to the spin liquid. But the green guy was not going in a nice, smooth, up and down snake pattern. It was trying to follow all the dimers. So it was like, yeah, a very strong bias in favor of that dimer pattern. The 1D was following each dimer. So it could essentially work with get that dimer pattern with an M of 2. But eventually you crank up M, and you see that all of the bonds, all the bonds are in the picture are having average subtracted out. Strong bonds and weak bonds now become a uniform bond strength. If there had been any spin order showing up, it would have shown up and plot would have shown this. But the spin order is very weak. And the chief question that we were trying to resolve is there a valence bond order versus the spin liquid? And so here you can see, we call the green line and see how it's trying to follow these dimer patterns, goes around. So that's what gives it the heavy bias. So it's an interesting thing. You can never say that all biases are gone in this kind of calculation. All of these methods are biased towards low entanglement states, because that's the main connective source of the representation. But with this sort of thing, you can actually tune the biases, and then when you see that it overcomes the biases to get the decision, it sort of reinforces your idea of what goes on.
When you say bias, do you mean in terms of your initial starting state or in terms of the external candidate?
So there's two biases here. So the first one is in the initial starting state, which was a dimer pattern, which is one of the competing states that sort of come up in analytic considerations. And the other case was your choice of the path. If something looks like a nice state along the one-dimensional path, because all of the dimers are near neighbor on the path, then that's a heavy bias in favor of that. And so if you just keep M to be very small, you'll just stay in that state. Okay. But then eventually you allow the calculation to have more freedom at the expense of more computation time. This 8,000 states is a heavy calculation, and we didn't really need this is just to prove a point that sort of deals with the biases. We tuned all the biases towards the valence bond. Once you sort of do enough of those, and you say, okay, we know that it's a spin liquid, then you just bias everything in favor of what you know is already there, and try to get the best calculation and crank up the size then. Because this isn't the biggest size that you can do either, just before the show is biased. I think this nice thing.